going on in the world, and that's good.
Day four, and we are in Kiev. This is the view from my hotel room window. I hear the kettle going there, but I'm just making today's meal, which is going to be a Tesco snack in the pot tomato and herb pasta. Delicious.
Sometimes we went back to our studio maybe twice, you know, but you want the place to be a wee bit different, you know. You don't want to get too comfortable and just, like it's going out to the local pub, you know.
Yeah, I don't think you want, you know, even the people, I don't mean any disrespect by it, but you don't want the people in the studio to get too comfortable with
that's
you
right.
being
that's
there.
Right, yeah.
You know, what's great about coming to a new studio is
that
they want to impress you as much as you want to impress them.
The four pieces, that's how we started, you know, and we went through that, and we tried different lineups.
And we had two guitar players.
Oh,
we had two guitar players and a keyboard player.
That's right, that was the Nazareth Orchestra, you know.
We should be able to escape in one car. That's always clever, you know. You know, if anything goes tits up, we can all get in one car and get the fuck out of town. You know, I always think that's good.
So that's
you don't have to leave anybody.
That's a criteria for the amount of people in your band.
One getaway car is good. You know what I mean?
3:14 in the morning in bastard Ukraine. You're late. Here goes. Yes, past the cases. Oh, along the corridor. I've played in loads of bands before Nazareth. I came to Perth to go to music school there, and when I finished there, really, my priority was just to somehow or other maintain a situation where I didn't have to get a proper job. In other words, to allow myself to still be a musician. So I just started, taking on any gigs that anybody would offer me a gig, I would take it. It didn't matter the style. I was doing a bit of teaching and I was doing a bit of working in a music shop and just various things to keep body and soul together, but not have to get a regular job. Totally out of the blue, Pete phoned me. And, you know, I'd met Pete and the rest of the guys loads of times. And in fact, you know, I'd been in a band that had supported them and stuff like that. And then he just phoned me up and he sort of said, well, Billy's left the band and, you know, we'd wondered if you might be interested. And I'm like,
That
needs to be digital together.
Oh,
you never
that with an analog pen.
No. He just said, well, bring a guitar down to this place that we're rehearsing and we'll run through a couple of songs. You know, he says, I mean, do you know any of the songs? I said, well, I know some of them, obviously. And I was so nervous I could barely play. But fortunately, I think as much as anything, because they'd heard me play before under some more normal circumstances, and basically they just offered me the job and that was it.
Tour would have been early in 1995, and it was the very first show was in Sweden.
The longer you are in a band, the more comfortable you get with all the people that you play with, and so you're a lot more relaxed about it, and confident, I suppose. And that's nice.
You better watch your back, boy. The blue lights flash. Cause you're under attack, boy. The gunshots crash.
Look, I mean, the most important thing to me is making sure that everybody's happy, and every one of us has worked under somebody who made you feel a bit negative about yourself, and I think that's so counterproductive. You know, it's even like when anyone's doing a take, you want to go, like, you want to pick the good part out of it. You know, you want to say, you know, whatever they're doing that's good about it, emphasise that.
Because we know what we're looking for here, and we know each other, and we know from the demos what we want, you know, and when we get it, of course, we're fantastically happy. We really are, you know what I mean? And that's how we should be.
I played with quite a few guitarists. Which one's your favourite?
Oh, you, Jimmy.
Really?
Aye. Because I thought, tonight...
What do you think is so good about me?
you're taller than most of them.
When Daryl Sweet died, it was just awful. I mean, it was just terrible. Down to do a sound check, and Daryl went, I don't feel right. And fortunately, because it was a festival, they had first aid people there. And the ambulance guys came round and straight to the hospital, but he was dead by the time he got there. It was a massive heart attack. So we sat around and we talked about it, and we figured, well, Dana would be the first guy to say, you know, come on then, what are we doing now then? Let's get on with it, you know? So then we got a hold of Lee and said, do you want to be the drummer? Because we couldn't have... He was just a natural choice. It just seemed natural that Lee would be the drummer.
I'd occasionally done some work for them because the original drummer, Daryl, he needed a drum technician because the guys that he were using couldn't make it on a couple of occasions. So I would come and fill in. But I never ever did that full time. So I started playing with the band in 1999, summer. I really enjoyed it. I think the first show was a small club gig, and then the second one was this music festival, which was in sort of upstate New York, and there was like 40,000 people. The way I get on with my dad now is the way I got on with him before I was playing with the band, so that's fine. I don't really think about it. It seemed a bit strange at first, but it's not something I even think about anymore. I mean, he's a pretty cool dad. So it's not affected our relationship either way.
Thank you very much. Peace and love.
My best friend in the whole world. Bum, da, 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 bum. Old bamboo, the old bamboo, the things you can do with the old bamboo. The old bamboo, the old bamboo, things you can do with the old bamboo.
All of the guys that work in the road crew, they all come from the same town, which is a place called Dunfermline in Scotland. And I've known them all ever since I was a kid. They're friends.
If you ever take a look at our website, we're probably one of the busiest bands in the world. I mean, we tour all the time, and you're in a different city almost every day.
Oh my God.
When you travel with a band, you have your what you wear on stage and what your day clothes kind of thing. And you hang your stage clothes up every night because they get wet. And you pack them last, but you don't unpack your suitcase. You just, you know, you put all the funky stuff to one side and the clean stuff to the other and go for the clean stuff in the morning, you know what I mean? You never unpack a suitcase. It's not like being on holiday.
Say 3 minutes for somebody who is going to pick up us. The hotel is just behind the corner, like 400 meters.
Well, we did the 40th anniversary tour a couple of years ago. We did 184 shows. Now, that's 184 shows. You don't remember the travel days, the days that are off between shows. So it means it was probably closer to 280 days that you were gone. I've got to try and learn a Scottish accent every time I go home because I forget and I'm late.
We left Pete in the petrol station in Canada. It wasn't intentional, it was at night and the guy stopped to fuel up. And of course, we were getting off the bus, we were supposed to tell the driver you're getting off the bus. Pete, of course, didn't. And then he went to the toilet and he was gone. And it was quite good though because the local police followed the bus back on the bus again. But we did have t-shirts made up, I got left and wherever it was.
Yes. I like to get here an hour and a half before we start. So that kind of gives me an hour just to sit and slowly and gently play my guitar, so I kind of warm the muscles of my hands up a bit. It's very important for me to do so because I've had trouble in the past from not doing it, so I'm gently first here.
I don't personally warm myself up before the show because you spend most of your days really trying to save enough energy up to do the show. So I don't, you know, I don't do that. I don't have to.
I don't warm up before the show. I cool down with a beer. Sorry, but I read a lot, and that's what I do when I'm travelling. So I get through a lot of books,
because you're travelling so much. You spend every day 5 or 6 hours travelling. And that's a lot of words, and that's a lot of chapters.
We don't really listen to a lot of music, you know, that's our job.
I read a lot and nap.
Watch the television, read a magazine, mess around on my drum pad, sleep. On the average day that we have, you would probably leave the hotel in the morning, travel for a few hours. You arrive in the hotel room, usually you have enough time to maybe have something to eat, take a shower, and then go to the show. So you're not really that bored sitting around in hotel rooms.
This is day 18, and something wonderful has happened. Look at this. We are staying in a proper hotel. Somebody at the door. Listen, English-speaking telly and everything. Amazing. Hold on, let's see who it is.
I'm so sorry.
Hello, do come in. See, it's just getting better. Look, look what's just happened. Thank you very much indeed.
It's the best part of your day, is the show, right? And it's the most fun part. So you kind of just look forward to that.
It's not like a nervous thing. I don't feel nervous before I go on, but there's definitely an adrenaline sort of buzz though. I mean, I love playing the big festivals, like we did Sweden Rocks, you know, and there's like earlier this year, and I think there was, you know, like you say, something like 70,000 there. And it's fantastic because you just get such a buzz.
With us being the situation we're in, you know, we're an old band now, or an old air band, and we're not going to get on Viva and MTV and all that, not. So for us to be seen by the people, we have to go to their city, you know, and that's the way we have to do it. Not that I mind, it's just a case of that's what we've done for years, you know, because we're too ugly for MTV.
When I go to see a band, I don't want to hear their latest album. I want to hear the stuff that
they're famous for,
that I loved them for. Yeah. You know,
you want to hear a couple of new things.
Yeah, that's fine, you know. But generally, you go like, okay, that's fine. Come on, you know, play.
Give me the stuff I know.
Give me the hits.
You know, people buy tickets because of Love.
They go to
hear a dog and that. Right? They want to hear what made you famous. Now, if you don't want to play them, stay at home.
No, don't go
out and do it. The Rolling Stones. You try to tell me they don't play Satisfaction, or you know, it's only rock and roll, but I like it.
When we bring out a new album and we start touring that year, because we generally will do rehearsals at the beginning of the year, and that's the set that we're going to play. Love Hurts is going to be there. Dream On is going to be there. There's Flight Tonight, Razzle and Dazzle, Hair of the Dog, and usually the hits that people have got that are hit in every country. We don't have that. We've got weird things. We've got songs that are huge in, like, Brazil.
Perfecto.
There are 3, maybe 4 songs that are huge there, but don't really mean that much anywhere else. But then, you know, and it's weird. So we've got to watch when we tour. You have to change this for this country and this for this country. And we went to Mexico, and we were going to play there. We'd never been in Mexico before, and the fans all got together and the promoter sent us this list of songs that they would like us to play. And there was 15 songs in it, and we only played one of them. You know, with Love Hurts, the rest of these songs, we don't play. With them, but when you look at these things and you realise a song that means nothing here, you know, means so much there.
In Europe, we have to play Dream On. It means absolutely nothing in North America.
It was number one all over Europe. I mean, it was
It was one of the biggest records we ever had. People at home, where we live, they didn't know it.